So I'll make it official.
Okay.
Thank you very much for joining me. It is my pleasure. And very quickly before I dive into the questions, I always like to include the audience to let them know like what happened. And these days, like, weird stuff is happening in my life. So like this.
I've seen some of it.
Yeah, right. So this, like, the fact that we're here is because I bumped into Jesse a few weeks ago by accident. And he invited me here. I'm like mind blowing. And then while I was here, I was talking to Jesse and he mentioned there's this instructor who's like really famous and it's really hard to book and he like travels all over the world. And I was like, oh, pretty cool. I wonder who this person is. And then you did yesterday the theoretical session. And I sat down and I was looking, and as soon as you showed the second slide, as soon as you started speaking, I was like, this sounds familiar. And then I saw the second slide and I'm like, I know this person, yes. So the quick story is that a couple years ago, I started questioning Aikido and I realized what I will want to ask you about, that martial arts and self-defense is different, but I had no source of information to guide me. Hmm. And one of my followers on YouTube sent me your podcast about the martial map.
Yes, yeah.
And I was driving and I was like, usually I'm trying to save my energy, but I was like, I'll listen, you know. And I started driving and I started listening. I was like, this is such good stuff. And by the end of my trip, I was like, my mind was blown. So many points by your narrative, how you explained it, just like everything clicked. I started to have a very different perspective. And that was the first time probably I realized that it's different. The combat sports, martial arts, and self-defense, they're different realms, interrelated. But yeah, it just gave me such a huge boost and understanding. And then that led me through a whole path, which influenced my work, my channel, everything. I just never said thank you. And this is the moment. So, and then, yeah, and we met and it's beautiful.
Yeah.
So thank you for that.
Yeah, it took me a second to recognize you too as well, didn't it? Because you had the hat on. As soon as the hat came off and the voice, I know this guy's channel, yeah. So yeah.
Well, I cut my hair and sometimes I hide behind, I'm here to film. So I'm like, I won't get in people's faces, but it's actually such a blast to know that actually you're familiar with what I do as well. That was like,
yeah, no, I've really enjoyed watching the channel, and I'm glad the Martial Map podcast was relevant to you too.
Definitely. I as I spoke to you yesterday, I realized, I was like, why did I never like say it out loud? But I guess I was still just in such early stages that things clicked with me, and only later as I progressed in my journey, I realized I always just remembered it, and so it was never like, everybody just take a look at us. Yeah. So now's the chance.
Yeah.
Well, I can explain the background of how that came about as well. One of my most influential instructors is a gentleman called Peter Considine. Mm. So some people may have been familiar with his work. Peter was a points fighter for the British team, fought full contact, has done military work, has worked as a bodyguard all over the world, run security businesses, worked as a doorman, you know what I mean? So Peter's one of the few people, I think, who has experienced combat or violence in all its various forms, you know, military, door work, you know, self-defense based stuff, always acted as a police trainer, all that kind of stuff. But he has a concept called, what he calls the box concept. So he said, whenever you're doing anything, you need to determine which box it's going to fit in. So is this I'm doing this because it's historically interesting, or I find it fun, or I find it therapeutic, or is this, I do this because it will help me to defeat another martial artist within a given framework, or do I do this for self-defense? He says, you've got to be mindful of which box it drops into. And Peter runs a training program, very in-depth, called the Combat Coach Program. So I did that, and as part of my my paper for one of the levels, I did the Martial Map, which is based on Peter's box concept, but it overlaps. So for those who haven't seen the podcast, it's basically three overlapping circles, like a Venn diagram, where we've got fighting, self-defense, and martial arts. And to me, those three things are not the same. They're all valuable and they're all great, but they're not the same, although they are interrelated. So fighting is when we agree, consensual violence, we agree to fight with another martial artist, we agree what the goal is, we agree what a win's going to be. Self-defense is keeping ourselves safe from criminals, which has a physical element, but that's only a relatively small part of it. You know, so non-consensual violence when it gets physical, and then they say we have the martial arts, which is the fun, enjoyment, the history, the culture. So they're all related, but they're not the same. And what I try and encourage people to do is, no matter what you're doing at any given moment, work out where it is on that map. What are you doing at this point? So if you're doing something because, I'm doing a technique designed for disarming a samurai. Lovely, that's historically interesting, you might enjoy doing it, great. That's not gonna help you in self-defense, you know what I mean? And it's not relevant to fighting. Or if I'm doing a judo turnover, I'm trying to pin a guy on his back. good. That's good for fighting. It's not good for self-defense because you want the exact opposite. You know, in martial arts, it's not really historically or culturally string, it's modern sports. It's just always working out where it fits on the map. And hopefully in the pod, what came across in that as well, it's not a value judgment of things being good or bad, it's just appropriate or inappropriate. That's a key thing. Yeah.
Yeah, that's, I feel that. I was still running my keto dojo at the day, and I remember that I kind of tried to go towards direction, but after I listened to your podcast, I became so clear about coming to my students and just letting them know, this is, we're not doing self-defense, at least 95% of the time. Like, maybe something might come in to use just accidentally, but we're not learning that. And when somebody would come in, I would sit them down, a new student, and I would say, like, what are you searching for? And they'd be like, self-defense. I'm like, well, this is the wrong place. Sorry, this is not self-defense. This is a martial art. So yeah.
Yeah, I would agree with that, because this is, for me as well, I think this is... Because martial arts don't know the difference, you know, generally speaking. So that's great, because what you're doing there is you're giving a very clear, honest answer. And that what I've tried to encourage, because I'll, like 90% of what I do in the dojo is not directly applicable to self-defense right. either. And we know that. Yeah. So we're doing it, okay, this is something we're doing for fun or for skill development or yeah. to help us defeat another martial artist. And these small amount of physical skills yeah. that will be directly relevant to a self-defense scenario. Now again, it depends how you talk about self-defense too, because... Most people who say that they want to learn self-defense, if your answer is, okay, great, train with me for the next 40 years, that's not a good answer. Most people who want to learn self-defense they don't want to devote an entire life to learning how to fight. Yeah. So you and I, as lifelong martial artists, will go, okay, we'll learn this wide set of skills, and then we'll decide which parts of that are relevant to the self-defense scenario. But a friend of mine, Jamie Club, has got a lovely analogy. He says, when students want to learn self-defense, he says, that's like someone saying, I want to learn first aid. Don't teach you to be a heart surgeon or a brain surgeon. So if you're a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt, you're a brain surgeon of ground right. combat. Yeah, do you know what I mean? Yeah. You are the elite level. If you're a high-level Thai boxer, you're the heart surgeon of striking. You know, you've taken these skills to a very high level. But for the self-defense purposes, it's the core physical skills, but it's mainly about, you know, are you aware of the nature of crime? Are you aware of what crime faces you in your particular environment? Do you know about escape? Do you know about de-escalation? How do you keep your house safe? What precautions have you got when you travel? What about when you go overseas? That's the stuff that works for most people. And most martial artists, because they don't know what's the wider part of self-defense, they go, oh, we'll just reduce it to the physical and we'll make it into a street fight. We'll move martial arts into the street and we'll say it's the same thing, whereas it's not. So yeah, I think no martial art is good for self-defense, because it's not self-defense. Only self-defense is good for self-defense.
Yeah. I think that's one of the biggest points which blew my mind when I was listening to your podcast. And you mentioned specifically, like, if you want to, like, if you're saying about running away, you have to practice running away.
Yes.
And I realized I never did that. And like, and I realized actually so many things. And that's where I actually conflicted with some of the Aikido people online or in conversations, because they would be like, you know, Aikido is better than, and they would compare it to MMA usually, but it's like, Aikido is better than me because it has no rules. It's like, you know, you can gouge eyes and you can bite and everything. I'm like, and after that talk, that podcast of yours, I realized we never practiced that stuff. It's like, how will you gouge an eye randomly just because you're an Aikido guy if you don't practice that? I realized it's nonsense. Yeah. It's just a lot of talk and no walk.
Yeah. I would say approach it like an engineer, right? So the engineer will go, what's the problem? How do I address the problem? Right. So if you went self-defense, what's the problem? I'm going to get a person who's not highly skilled, you know what I mean? What's the objective of the criminal? Well, to do harm in a given way. You need legally, you've got to work that in. So you need knowledge of the law, and we need to facilitate escape. Mm-hmm. So people say things like run away, but that's equivalent if I said, oh, I've got a Thai boxing bout next week, and I go, just kick and punch him.
Right.
Well, shall I practice that? Shall I practice that? No, just do what I've said. Yeah, yeah. So it's the same when people go, just run away and escape. It's just words. There are skills associated with that, mm-hmm. which need practice. And the eye gouging thing is one I always find interesting as well, because I call that the rules paradox, right? So mm-hmm. you'll see this, like, you'll get sometimes classical jiu-jitsu guys who'll go, oh yeah, we don't practice this throw, it's too dangerous, the guy would land on his neck, so we don't practice it. But the judo guys, they practice safe throws. Well, in my experience, I know who's more likely to throw me than not. The guy who's made it safer, paradoxically, is also the guy who's more effective, because he's allowed to practice it against a live resisting opponent. So for the self-defense stuff, we're going to do this actually in the next session. Right. We'll get them to practice that stuff, but live, but we'll go, okay, we're doing a grappling drill. I want you to get your thumb here. Right. So when they're practicing, they're getting used to, okay, I have to defend against that, and they're getting it close, but in a way that's safe. And, you know, I mean, you poke a guy in the eye, it's not like they drop to the floor and the fight's over. They can be useful as part of the whole. but they're not winners. And I think sometimes people use that as an out. So, with MMA as well, I think if we've got, when it comes to holistic fighting, I think modern MMA has proved itself to be supreme at that. Yeah. But if people are going to it to learn self-defense, there are all kinds of, do you practice running away? Do you practice if there's more than one person? Do you consider how your actions are going to be perceived by witnesses? I punch the guy, falls to the ground, I jump on top of him and can repeatedly keep punching him. Superb to win that bout. You get done for assault because the witnesses believe, what did you see? I saw a guy fall on the ground, the other guy jumped him and kept punching him. But if that's your conditioned habit, you have a problem for self. If your conditioned habit is the guy is falling, I run away screaming, stay down, don't hurt me. Then that's self-defense. You know, and the difference is, I think it's appropriate, inappropriate. So people go, oh, MMA doesn't work in self-defense. It's the missing the point. It's what appropriate skills have you got that you can move across. You know, and it's first aid. So my thing is, let's get the first aid in place. And then let's, okay, I want to be, you know, find what, you know, for me, it's karate. I love it. Okay, so then I'm going to explore that massively. Or if Aikido is your thing, or MMA is your thing, or boxing, or whatever it happens to be, you go, okay, the self-defense side of it. So, for example, if Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu was my art, I would teach preemptive striking, rapid palm heels, some escape drills. Yeah, we're done. You know what I mean? I've got all of that. And then that's a self-defense side of thing covered. Now I can explore the wonderful world that is groundwork and consensual fighting with another martial artist, free of the need to feel some false link back, you know what I mean? And martial artists of all stripes do it all the time. So, but just, you know, train for what you want to train for. Be specific in your training.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. There's one, I'm pretty sure, like, inspired by what you said and a few other influences, I came to a realization that the hardcore martial artists, the nerds, we spend like decades preparing for that one time when we will get attacked. And sometimes some of the people will never get attacked. It's like, it's like you have to prepare for that, but it's not as likely as, like, I don't know, some years ago or whatever. But then we're preparing for that one time for 20, 40, 60 years training, like hours and hours. It's like if you want to do self-defense, then just go to a self-defense course, you know, do like a weekend, like a solid good self-defense course, a week, a month, and then you're done. And then learn whatever you want. Like you said, like do it as a hobby, become like a grappler or a striker or a karate expert, whatever. It's like, don't mix them up. So I think, yeah, that.
Well, it's like first aid, right? So first aid, you do a refresher course once every 3 years. Mm. Do the same. You know, go on a self-defense course once every 3 years, you know what I mean? And you go, that life skill, I've got the basics of that down, right? And then because martial arts don't like that, they try and reinvent it. Yeah, but what happened if you fight a taekwondo Olympian in self-defense or BJ, the statistics are so low. And again, no one wants to be that guy who goes, yeah, I spent 40 years training this thing and no one tried to stab me. What a complete waste of time that was. You know what I mean? You need to find, there needs to be, and there is, I think when people go self-defense, they've often been lazy in the motivations. So they go, why are you doing it? They go, self-defense is a simple answer. You know, if you're the kind of person who's getting attacked every week, there are lifestyle or personality issues that need addressed. And for us as martial artists, we find that one, so for me, you know, the reason that I've stuck with karate, I mean, I've studied other martial arts too, but the reason that karate is not because I believe it's the ultimate or the most deadly one, it's because there's something about it that I find attractive. So I'm able to go back to it day after day, hour after hour, year after year, decade after decade, and I'm still doing it in a way that, like, boxing, judo, kickboxing, they haven't been able to hold my attention in the same way. But that doesn't mean they're better or worse, it's just personal preference. And I think, you know, find the martial art that suits you, get the self-defense elements of that, and you say, okay, I understand what those bits are, and then being free to enjoy, you know, like, I'm 47 years old now, so I care about my health a lot more than I used to. You know, when I was younger, my body was my enemy. I just, you'd break it and come on, do it again, you know. But now, I like the fact that the karate is keeping me, when I compare myself to my peers, I'm in pretty good shape for a 47-year-old guy. And again, so the karate is giving me that, and that matters. So, yeah, well, there's all these wide benefits. I don't think we should throw them out. We just need to be mindful of what we're training for at any given point. And I sometimes think people go self-defense because it's a lazy answer. Yeah. You know, yeah, why do you train self-defense? You know, because, you know, I the honest answer, you know, if someone says to me, why do you karate? Because it's fun. That's it. That's the only reason I do it. You know, I mean, I believe that, I mean, we'd all improve, but if after, you know, in my 44th decade of training, if I haven't got the basics of self-defense down now, I never will. Yeah. You know, I mean, it was a long time indeed since I ever needed those skills in reality, but I'm still training for it. My lifestyle now is such that I think the chances of me being a victim of a violent crime are minimal, but I still just enjoy the practice of it. So that's why I keep doing it.
One more thing I wanted to bring up is, for exploring the subject myself, I came to a definition of the difference between explanation and what I call justification. And I feel like you addressed that quite a bit as well in terms of like karate katas, and there's a lot of like stuff in Aikido as well where like, so why do we do this? And the instructor, first of all, most times doesn't honestly know, never really thought about it, or give us a half-assed answer from someone else more superior than him, who said, we do this because, you know, as he showed one of the examples, like there's a kick and somebody punches from the back and you also defend, and you're like, that's not an explanation, that's a justification. So
lovely distinction. I like that. Yeah. Right.
So what do you feel, what's really interesting for me is like, what do you feel makes people do that? Why does phenomena exist?
I'm no psychologist, but my guess would be is that they feel heavily invested in something. It becomes part of who they are. So therefore, they feel that an attack on that part of them, you know what I mean, is an attack on them as an individual. And like someone who, like, I'll give an example, right? So kata is something that I think viewed, you don't have to do kata, of course you don't. You become competent in self-defense fighting without doing it, but it's an attractive center stone for me to work from, and I believe looked at in the historical way it's useful. But there are things I picked up from karate that I don't believe are useful. So for example, 3-step and 5-step sparring where the guy kind of runs it and you just block, but I've dumped all of that. Now and when I've publicly gone, this is why I don't practice that, because I believe it to be a martial dead end, you know, people go, oh, timing and distancing. So they try and do a justification. I go, yeah, but it's the wrong timing and the wrong distancing. It's good for beginners. Well, there's other ways in which beginners can train that's effective. And as they throw these justification arguments, I will steal that, by the way. As they throw these justification arguments at you when they get knocked down, and then it becomes very personal. Do you know what I mean? So I'll get accusations of you just being offensive. No, I'm just saying what I believe to be true. You know what I mean? I'm just, or you're being arrogant. Well, so I'm arrogant for saying what I believe, but you're not for saying what you believe. You know, there's a double standard there as well. Or if you only train more, then you would understand. Well, if I'm not getting it after like 37 years of training or whatever it's been, I'm never going to get it, right? There's a fault in the method. And people do take it very, very personally, but I think that's it. And you get... So for me, the thing is, I'm happy to let things go that I don't feel are serving me, because life's short. So I don't want to spend time doing things just because somebody said I should. So like 1-step sparring, 3-step sparring, 5-step sparring, very common in the karate world, don't do any of it. Simply because I don't believe it has any utility for any of the things I want. Now, if someone went to me, you know, yeah, we don't believe it's combatively useful, but I like the art of it. I think it looks pretty cool. You know, they've asked me to do it for gradings. Brilliant. You've got a reason for doing it. But once you make an empirical claim for it, it will make me a better fighter or able to, no, come on now, because we've got empirical tests for that, you see.
Well, that's something else, leads me to ask something else I'm very curious to ask. So I've been in a lot of trouble, but I admit, I take personal responsibility. I was too pushy at a certain point. I just got frustrated with people hating me, and I kind of hated back. So I went into war with the Aikido world and the traditional martial arts world. And so I got a lot of heat. And I feel like, you know, like you said, like sometimes you say something which makes sense and it triggers other people, which I feel is a bad sign.
Yeah.
Because probably if it would be nonsense, if you like say to a thin person that he's fat, he'd be like, what are you talking about? But if the person feels a bit overweight and you say he's fat, and then he's like, no, I'm not fat. Anyway, so there's
you've touched like, the nerve. Yeah,
right, exactly. Yeah. But then eventually I dropped it. I realized this is not getting me anywhere, this whole kind of aggression versus aggression. But it gets to that if there's that seeking for truth. So yeah. I wonder, in those discussions, in searching for truth and presenting the truth of what you discover about self-defense martial arts, where's your balance in terms of fighting that?
Well, so this is lovely. Obviously, this is why I like talking to Jesse too, because someone who has an online presence as well, right. I know exactly what you mean in a way that viewers may not. So, yeah, I all day, every day, I've got people throwing things, you know what I mean? Which I get, you know, if I'm putting information out in the big wide world, I should expect critique back. Yeah. My personal thing with it is whenever I put information out, I'm never trying to offend, I'm never trying to upset, I'm always just saying, here what it is. And you were there last night, the very first thing I said to everybody is, this is my way of doing things, it doesn't need to be yours, I'm just presenting it as I feel. So this is my and if it's useful to you, great, and if you don't like it, that's fine too. When you get that triggered reaction, I found there's generally two types. So there's some people who go, they want to understand what you're saying, but they believe you said said something else. They believe you said something derogatory or offensive. So with those people, it can be good to go, okay, because sometimes it's terminology. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what do we mean by kata? What do we mean by sparring? What do we mean by... So you kind of break it down a little bit, and then you often get people go, I get where you were coming from. I agree with you. I don't agree with you, but we understand one another. Those discussions, I think, are always really useful. Then you'll get other people who go, no, I just want to prove you wrong. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You have to agree with me on this because something you've said I don't like for any given reason. Those discussions, what I tend to do is I'll engage with them for so long because I think they'll be useful for other people to read. Because that person, by challenging me, they're getting me to present my best argument. Right. And when we've reached the point where I feel this is now, you are not going to move, I am not going to move, and people reading this are just going to see the same things repeated, I tend to go, well, thanks for talking. Yeah. You know what I mean? I've enjoyed the discussion, I'm out. And that's when I tend to stop it. And they always try and draw you back in, but you just leave it that little bit, yeah. No, I was going to say, I know exactly where you're coming from because I get that a fair bit. Yeah.
Because when I was listening to you, like, especially the Marshall Map podcast, it was just so clear. You like really, sometimes I don't articulate things as well as I feel I should. And then that's where sometimes, like you mentioned that kind of miscommunication. It's like I presented the facts or the ideas in such a way where people can still interpret and they interpret in a way which doesn't work. But then when I listened to your Marshall, I was just like, this is like broad daylight. There's no shadows here. Like there's nothing to say anything about. And when I listen to your other talks, you seem like very, in a way, like diplomatic, maybe that's the right word. Like you are open. You don't say like, this is the truth. And that's what oftentimes trigger people if you're like one-sided. You're very much inclusive. So I thought you don't get as much heat, but it sounds like...
No, I do. but I think is there's definitely... I always think... the way science communicates ideas, I think, is a good example of this. Because science goes is, well, this is the best explanation we've got of all the information we have, right? You know, scientists will ever go, you must believe this to be correct. And if evidence comes that shows them to be wrong, they go, okay, we change our mind because the evidence is there. So I try and keep an open mind. And I also find that... if I let the information do the talking, people are generally more receptive to it than if I go, you're wrong, I'm right, let me tell you why. You know what I mean? So if I go, you will have your way of doing martial arts, which are entirely valid for you. I have my way of doing things, which are entirely valid for me. I want to show you what I do, and hopefully some of it will be useful to you. Take the bits that are, then that's a useful conversation we can have, and I'll do that with other people. I'll look at people do things, I go, right, that doesn't fit with what we do, I don't agree with them on that, I like that. You know what I mean? So it's always just trying to be as open and receptive as you can. There's a wonderful thing about the internet age, right? We can share information like never before. Yeah. And to some people, they're horrified by this idea. Mm. And in other places, well, this is great. I can learn from a guy on the other side of the world within minutes of him uploading a video. I'm hearing his words. I'm learning something. So, there's a place for diplomacy. Yeah. So long as it doesn't become that false. Because again, I think sometimes you get that expectation that... everyone's got a right to hold an opinion, you know, but they don't have to have that opinion respected or be correct. So I'll get this where people they'll go, this is true, you know, it's not, and it's not my experience, and I can show you historical evidence, practical experience, I can show you lots of reasons why that's not correct. But then they get offended because they say, no, you have to respect my opinion. No, I have to respect you as an individual. Yeah, you know what I mean? So, but if your opinion is something I fundamentally disagree with, I've got a right to say I believe that to be wrong. In the same way, everyone's got to, you know, they can say I'm wrong too. And I'm always happy as well is when the discussions are based on the information, they're good discussions. Yeah. I'm sure that sometimes it becomes, you know, oh yeah, but you do this professionally. So you're saying that for the money, as if I had some great idea to get these, right. I want me some of these bunk-eyed billions, you know what I mean? Some great master plan I've got, you know. But they'll question your motivations. But I think if you're speaking honestly, people will have a hear for it, will hear, and there'll always be that subset of people that never want to change. There's no point talking to them. It's of zero benefit to anybody. So I always, if you quickly realize it doesn't matter what evidence you present, they are dogmatically fixed to their position. You go and enjoy your thing. There's no point of me talking to you because neither of us is going to get anything out of it.
I'm nearing towards my last question, but you reminded me of something. So I won't pick names because this is, you know, online platform and everything. I respect those people, but there's video released not long ago by two individuals. One, let's say, a traditional martial arts expert who does what I personally believe is not necessarily confused, but he's doing a disfavor because he's in the martial arts, strongly in the martial arts realm, but he presents it as, it's like for the streets. It's always for the streets. It's like that mystical, what is that street? Where's that street? Show me that street. Yeah. You know?
Sounds like a dangerous place.
Right, exactly. So it's very fixated about that. And he meets with a person who's experienced in the combat sports realm, and also I feel has pretty solid knowledge about self-defense. Yeah. But then when they meet, the self-defense expert goes like, yeah, everyone, you know, it's like, and he doesn't challenge anything, and he's like, they show their demonstrations, and he's like, yeah, there's truth in everything, and every there's a truth to everything they do, and it's just like, he kind of presented in such a way that everyone is right, and I was like, I felt like this is a disfavor to human intellect, and even dangerous, because that's what frustrates me about self-defense, because it's a life or death matter, potentially, and if we present the wrong information, because it makes us feel better, we are endangering people.
It is, and that to me is abhorrent, right? Because what you're doing at that point, I mean, as we talked about, the chances of people being a victim of violent crime are minimal. You know what I mean? They are minimal. Yeah. But if you go to preserve the integrity of my style or to preserve my own ego, I will put out information that I either A, know to be false, or B, have never checked if it is false. Mm. Both of those are negligent. You know, really, really dangerously negligent. And one of the stories we talked about last night, I have had students who have faced very dangerous situations and have got out of them because I taught them run, and I taught them, but if I had taught them, let's put this lock on, let's do this stroke, throw that roundhouse kick, this will work in the street. It can have very severe consequences, you know, so.
Interesting enough, you remind me, I've been there, like literally been there. There was a situation where I was a teenager studying Aikido very dedicatedly, and my instructor was all about the martial arts, and it's the same as self-defense. There's no difference. It's like, you don't need to distinguish. Just practice the techniques, and one day they'll automatically come in, right? Kind of that myth. And five guys came up to me, and they're like, give me your mobile phone. They were still expensive back then. And my first instinct, somebody grabbed me, and I punched the guy. And then he lost half of his consciousness, and the other guys are screaming, ah, like they didn't expect it to happen. And they're like, what do we do? What do we do? And I come into my Aikido stance. I'm like, okay, you know, Aikido is all about the defensive. I'm like, okay, I'm going to wait for them to defend. I'm looking if they have knives. And I'm standing there. There's like loads of space. Yeah. I could have run like 10 times. And now eventually I got pepper sprayed and ran away, thankfully. But so I didn't get hurt. But when I look back, I'm honestly frustrated. Also, it's like, I can't blame my first instructor because you don't know what you don't know. But I realized, part of me was frustrated because I realized he did not tell me that simple. And it's not self-evident for me until especially in that martial arts realm, it's like, if you're a black belt, you need to win. You know, it's all about winning. It's all about winning. And it almost puts you in that kind of pressure situation where you have to prove.
Exactly. You know? Which is why martial arts are often bad for self-defense. Right. I always say this, the worst self-defense instructors are martial arts instructors, because they teach, of all stripes, because they teach martial arts, does it? So I got an email it was from a guy who told me he'd been sitting at a train station. Mm. He saw two guys walking. He saw one of them had his hand cupped. He thinks he's holding something. He sees the other guy's got a knife. He drops his luggage and he runs away. Right, so he writes to me and then going, I've been training in Kyokushin karate for years. I have a second dan in this. I feel like such a failure. I feel so unmanly. I ran away from these guys. I want to know what you would have done differently. So I wrote back and said, you know what? That was perfect self-defense. You were aware of your surroundings. You spotted it. You jetted into things that weren't important. You ran. You should be really proud of yourself. That was textbook. You didn't even get a scratch. You could not have done that better. Yeah, well, it's really kind of you to say, but I know you're just saying it to be nice. You know, so because his instructors have conditioned that it's to win. It's to win. So not only if he'd stood up and gone, okay, let's go, he could have been badly damaged, but psychologically he's damaged because he ran and now feels he's less manly for having done so. So, I mean, the first bit we've been including in all the drills we've done today, you hit him, you run. As soon as he's sort of you run. So that becomes the conditioned reflex, as you say, not to stand there and go, let's fight on, you see. Yeah. So I think, that would be one very good, simple test. If people are training at a club, how do you practice escaping? Do you practice running away? Do you practice escaping? Because that's another one, you know, with groups. People go, you can't outfight groups. That's right, you can't outfight groups, but you can run away from groups. And there are tactics and methods by which you can do that. And it's something you need to be practicing. The escape is the key thing. Yeah, but again, people think it's going to happen by magic. I'll say the words run away and you know how to do it. Yeah. You know, or the other one is talk your way out if you can. Uh-huh.
How?
Yeah, yeah, teach me how.
Right.
Yeah, teach me. Yeah, teach me de-escalation skills. Teach me those skills, right. And let's practice those skills. Right, not just go and do it. And that's why I say, because that's not in the realm of martial arts, people don't know it and don't teach it. Right. So the one thing, just to wrap up the thing, but I would just add on is, because I think that moral question of, if someone knows that they don't know they're teaching adequate self-defense, but teaches the martial arts anyway, then we'd all agree that's immoral and negligent, right? And then there's a question, but if the person doesn't know that what they're teaching is incomplete, are they immoral then? And that's a grayer area, but I would say they are. Yeah. Because if I go to your house and say, oh yeah, I know how to install a boiler safely, and then your house blows up as a result, you know, that's negligent on me. I shouldn't assume I know, I should check. So this is where I've been lucky, that I have had instructors who are very well educated in these areas, who are very well experienced in these areas. So it was always part of my education. So maybe the difference is more stark for me than maybe it is for others. But there is good information out there. You Jeff Thompson's, your Peter Considine's, Rory Miller's, Mark Mickey Young, people like this who have fantastic, good quality information in that realm. Educate yourself with it. It's there to be had, and then compare that to how you're training and teaching, and say, well, is it a fit? If you're claiming to teach self-defense as an element, and if you're not, that's great too. So long as you're clear on that with yourself and all your students, it's not that the street is some gold standard. You know what I mean? The street. It's if you're doing it because you like the artistic expression of it, and that's where you go there, great. You know what I mean? But you just need to be truthful with yourself about your objectives, and then make sure you're delivering those objectives. Mm. Yeah, that's what I say. That's practical. Is whatever your objective is, you're achieving it. Yeah.
I'll share a quick funny story. I think you'll like it. And then I'll ask a question. So when I started crushing Aikido, after a while, I became kind of the established, you know, person of, okay, this is the guy who pokes holes at Aikido, and like on some forums, people would be like, ask a question. So does Aikido work? A lot of people are like, check this guy, you know, watch his channel, and you'll get some of the answers. So knowing that I was for a while about that, I even got some phone calls sometimes, and there was this one phone call, or emails as well, but that phone call specifically, that guy was like, Rokas, I feel like I really have some valuable information to you to give, like, which will make you understand how Aikido can work as a self-defense martial art. And I got loads of emails like that and messages. I'm just like, makes me vomit. You know, it's just like, feels bad. I'm like, you guys don't know what you're talking about. But I have this phone call, direct conversation. You know, I'm not gonna just put down the phone. I'm like, so what I asked the guy, I'm like, oh, so you do you know really well about, you know, the rituals of I'm trying to figure out my English right now, but like the rituals of
the monkey dancers, right?
Yeah, right, exactly, exactly.
Rituals of violence.
Yeah. Or do you know can you give me some advice about de-escalation? Or you know, it's like, what about the best ways of escaping, or just assessing the situation? I'm like, are we going to talk about that? And the guy's like, well, no. I'm like, are you sure you know like what self-defense is about and what you want to, like, what advice you want to give me? And he's like, well, I'm not sure. I'm like, okay, then let's finish the conversation, because people are so fixed thinking that it's all about the technique.
Yeah.
It's just like, and that's actually where it leads me to a question, which again for me was mind-boggling, and I've been there too actually. So studying Aikido for years, becoming an instructor, and wanting people around me to learn safety, to learn self-defense, but it never came across to me the idea that I should. As a martial arts instructor, I should get certified. I should get education in the self-defense realm. That's like my, almost like I have to, it's a must. It should be like a common sense thing, but it never came to my attention until years later. And it seems like the same with some other instructors. They just feel like they need to train more years, and eventually they're just gonna, but it's just, it doesn't happen. But that idea doesn't come for them. You know, I'm an instructor in martial arts, so I should become an instructor in self-defense as well. So why do you think that thought doesn't come, in your opinion?
Yeah, I think it's because they believe them to be one and the same, yeah. And I would also say it's getting harder for people to do that now. Because if they have any connection with the outside world, if they ever go online, there's a lot more people making clear the distinction, I think.
Right, yeah.
So I quite regularly now, having, you know, and I compartmentalize things, so there's some things that I do that have no relevance to it, and there's some things I do for historical interest, or some things are for outsparring. I'm aware of where we are, but when we talk about the self-defense thing, I'm forever saying, you know, all the, you know, do you know about de-escalation? Do you know about criminal behavior? Do you have crime statistics? Do you know all that kind of stuff? And I'll get emails from people go, where do I learn that? So there's definitely people going, okay, that thought has occurred to me now. You know what I mean? Yeah. And then I think it's also a matter of like educating as the instructors as best we can. Again, you'll get some that will never listen. Right. But I think the message is definitely getting out. And you know, these things, it's always turning that tanker sometimes takes a while. Yeah. You know, but I'm hoping within 10, 15 years or so, it'll be that. That idea of teaching martial arts in jeans is what one of my instructors called. They don't teach self-defense, it's martial arts in jeans. Once that starts to slowly diminish, then hopefully the realism is... And the fact as well, people realizing that... I think the other bit that will help is you don't have to tie everything back to self-defense. It's totally legit to say, why do you do this? It's fun. Yeah. I like it. It's how we compete when we fight each other. Yeah. That's totally okay. It doesn't always need to be, you know, self-defense is the gold standard. Yeah. And that's what I tried to get across in that martial map idea. Is you judge an orange by how orangey it is. You judge an apple by how apple-y it is. Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah. You don't judge everything by the standards of one, you know. And I try when I'm teaching, because I do like to move around that map a little bit, I try and always mark where we are. So hopefully for the instructors that I'm working with as well, they get a bit more clear. Ah, okay. You know, I see how we've moved there. And hopefully it encourages them to seek out those soft skills, if we can use that term, that traditional martial arts are desperately lacking. Yeah. Mm.
That would have been actually my next question, but you kind of pretty much answered it. But the idea itself, do you think that years later, eventually the information will spread enough? Because like, even like with, like MMA, for example, really showed the lacking side of combat sports, I call it, in certain martial arts, that it showed that if you're like practicing this certain martial art, it will not work in a consensual fight really that well. But some styles, some schools are still like kind of hidden in some, I don't know, garage, and they're like, no, we're better. But they never test themselves. So it's kind of just mad that some people just don't go through.
And I think that's they're like the other people we talked about. They're the ones we're never going to reach. Right. Do you know what I mean? We're never going to reach them, so we just need to. They'll eventually reduce in numbers, and you know, they'll be.
Hopefully
there'll be 2% of the martial arts out there eventually. So they're there. You know, I mean, it's just ridiculous. I always like that law. Yeah, in MMA, you're not allowed to attack the fingers. So you know, but you are allowed to elbow each other full power in the head. Yeah, right. Yeah, I know. You know. Which do you want? A finger lock? I mean, elbow. Right. Okay, finger lock, please. Yeah. So, I think it's, hopefully that's what will happen. They'll just become more and more isolated as time goes on. And I think there's an onus on us all to try and make sure that happens, you know, by presenting the alternative and then challenging where it's necessary to challenge as well.
But your vision is that eventually it will spread out in such a way that it'll become a common norm for martial arts to distinguish that it's... martial arts, combat sports, or you're called fighting.
Fight fighting, yeah, but to say, yeah. Well, the reason
I'm actually limiting it too much. Like combat sports is like consensual fighting is not really a sport.
No, because you could have two guys who go, let's step outside the pub car park and sort it out, then that's a consensual fight as well. Right. But combat sports are definitely a subsection of consensual combat. Right.
The vision is basically that they will eventually become a kind of a common standard to realize these are different.
And I think we can see that happening. You know what I mean? I think if you were to, say a wrist lock is the most devastating move in combat, you know, then you can say, well, we've got a 20-year experiment called MMA that shows they don't prop up that often.
Right.
You know what I mean? So you could say, well, in that consensual realm, that's a non-technique. Do you know what I mean? Right. So I think... you see, like, for example, we need to do more, but a lot of karateka adopting, because that's my background, so traditional martial art, but you see more and more of them adopting traditional protection, head guards and stuff, and modern gloves are better, you know what I mean? We don't have to hit a makiwara as often because we now have punch bags and focus mitts and tie pads. And so I think you see that change where the people are open to modern kits and modern ways of training. So you have to believe that it's happening. But I think there'll always be that subset. And it reinvents itself as well. The danger with it as well is you get, it kind of goes in cycles. So I have a friend who does BJJ, and he says you'd be amazed at how many of the problems that karate had 40 years ago, BJJ is getting now. So you get, you know, we've got fake black belts appearing and people who have black belts who've never tested anything. And, you know, there's you know, that say, or believe, you know, with the ultimate, it's perfect now, there's nothing more to learn. Yeah. You know what I mean? I think he can, and I don't know enough about BJJ, but those in the community say that's happening in certain pockets.
I'd say like sports element, just so some guys are so focused on the sports element that it's a habit to go on the ground, for example, and that's not a go for multiple opponents. And I could
So again, you teach some preemption, you teach some simple escape skills, the de-escalation, all that kind of stuff. Rapid par meals, that's it. And then if you end up on the ground, well, that guy's going to have a bad day, right? So I think that's the idea, is just contextualizing it. And it's the same, it's exactly the same, you know, like from the karate background that I come from. So the par mealing, the elbowing, the gripping, the breakaway stuff, that would overlap with the self-defense element. Mm-hmm. The guards up, the moving back and forth does not, the provoking trained response does not, the higher level kicking does not, the throws and takedowns that we do, some of the joint locking we do doesn't move across the self-defense. It's useful for consensual violence, it can be useful for the martial arts and the fun and training, but you're aware of which bits are relevant. I think that's always the key bit for me, is just be mindful of what you're training for in any given moment. And hopefully, as that message spreads, more and more people will start to think that way, and then being critical about what they do. So not, you know, the king is dead, long live the king kind of thing, you know what I mean? We just make the same mistakes repeatedly. Because I think, you know, that can happen too. Yeah.
Two last questions, so we had enough time for coffee. Very quick idea before I ask the questions, what I thought as you spoke, like flat earthers, you heard about those?
Yeah.
Like with all the evidence and everything you have, if they're still flat earthers, must be like some martial artists will never, they're just hopeless.
Yeah. That's a fascinating subculture for me. It's a YouTube rabbit hole as well with all the cat. There's a couple of, they keep popping up in my feed now, you know what I mean? So I've looked at one too many. Yeah. But yeah, that's right. There's always going to be people who are going to believe whatever they want to believe, no matter what. Yeah.
So the last two questions. The first one is, there's that phenomena that happens very common with Aikido, I'm sure with karate too. Like when you start to show the people the pathway, like this is the karate traditional form and this is how you could apply it more in a self-defense situation. And some people get frustrated and they're like, this is not karate anymore.
Yeah,
this is not Aikido anymore. And it's like, for me, I'm pretty sure we think alike in the sense like that it doesn't have to be.
Yeah.
But like what's your, like, what do you stand in that situation? If somebody is like, well, this is not karate anymore, what would you say?
My standard answer is, it is the way I do it. Do you know what I mean? So it's because nobody owns the label. I mean, karate is an odd one because it's like a friend of mine says, karate is a term like athletics. Mm-hmm. So you go like, so I do athletics. Great. Are you a marathon runner or a shot putter? Because they're two very disparate disciplines. Yeah. So karate's almost become this coverall term for a wide range of different things. But and also I think you have this idea that which is an odd thought really. No field of human endeavor is thought to have reached its peak in the 1940s, but some people in karate believe it did. In the 1940s, it was perfect, and anything else beyond that point is an abomination. Well, and if you look at like Funakoshi, the father of modern karate, as I say, he goes, times change, the world changed, and martial arts must change too. You know, so and there's others. You know, people comparing karate to being a pond and it needs fresh water coming in, otherwise everything in it dies. Yeah. So to me, the true tradition has been one of constant evolution. It's never been trying to preserve it in amber. So I'll sometimes, like, we use a lot of focus mitt drills, and I'll get some people go, they're not traditional. Mm-hmm. I go, no, I picked these up from boxing and kickboxing, but I can use them in a way that's really useful. So I'm not gonna reject that for some false notion of purity. So, I always say, I'm a martial artist first, I'm a karateka second, and I have no idea what style I am. That's the idea, you know. So I've long since abandoned the idea of belonging to any particular karate style, because I do what I do. I do believe I practice what I do within a karate framework. So we do have solo templates, we wear gis and belts, and that helps make it that way. But above all, I'm a martial artist first. One little demo that one of my instructors got us to do. We were teaching at a seminar, and he got myself, who's a karateka, Danny, who's a skilled Thai boxer, and Peter, who's a friend of mine, who's a skilled full contact fighter kickboxer. And he got us all to do the same combinations on the pads, right? and then at the end of it, we'll do it all. And then he turned, there's 200 martial artists there. He goes, what was the difference? And one guy goes, they were dressed differently. And anyway, that's exactly it. That's exactly it, you know. So because I have a gi on and a belt, when I do my Toba Komazuki Gakazuki, and when the boxer does his jab cross, it's still the same thing essentially. We just train it in different ways, we use different terminologies. There's a lovely line, there was like a guy, which I thought he said, we're talking about this, how it's often, you change the terminology and you train the uniform, and that's often changing the art almost. Mm-hmm. And in response to this point being made, he says, yeah, you're right. He says, so I don't know about cross-training. Maybe all I've done is a lot of cross-dressing. and I thought that was just a beautiful line. Yeah. So, you know, and I get that. Like, so today are karate guys, but if I was teaching, say, like someone, like, which I get, people go, well, Krav Maga groups, come and do something for mm-hmm. us. Well, I'll maybe do it in shorts and a t-shirt. I'm still doing the same thing, but now it seems to have changed context a little right. bit, yeah. So, yeah, it's to me, no one owns that label of karate. If I want to apply the label to it, they do. And if for them it's not karate as they do it, fine. But it is karate as I do it. You know? Yeah.
And the very last question for this one, for people who are in that transition, who are not clear about the difference between the different realms or what self-defense is, what self-defense is not, probably quite stuck in the narrow field of martial arts, mm-hmm. What would be your advice? What would you say to such a person who maybe the cracks are happening, but that person is unsure?
Yeah, well, first thing is you don't have to learn everything overnight. Mm-hmm. So I think sometimes if people have become an expert in martial arts, mm-hmm. they want to be, well, I want to be an expert in self-defense immediately. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. You have a lot of experience and you'll have some transferable mm-hmm. skills within that. Park that and then take your time to learn it and learn it right. So mm-hmm. seek out good sources, good quality sources of information, and there are a lot of them out there. Yeah. And then just take your time to slowly digest it and to slowly make that change. Because I think sometimes people go, oh, well, wait, I don't know what the law is. I don't know about right. chemical responses to dangers. I don't know all these de-escalation strategies. I don't know about crime stats. You know, fine, just take it step by step by step, slowly, and you know, you'll get there. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this again, start with, books-wise, I think Jeff Thompson's Dead or Alive book is a brilliant book to start with. You've got Peter Constantine's Streetwise. Anything written by Rory Miller is a good place to start, you know what I mean? So, because these are articulate guys who understand the difference between the two, and then just you know, educate yourself on it, yeah.
It's a great advice, and I realize I was there too, in that sense of spending so much time in martial arts, believing that I should be good in self-defense. And when I decided I need the self-defense skills, I was in the sense of, I need to do this like as quick as possible. And it's like, not the right way to go.
So. No. Just, gradually. Yeah. And then as we talked about yesterday, be clear. The first thing would be just be clear on the differences.
Mm. You know what I mean? So if you're aware of, you know, how physically, you know, the exchanges happen a bit differently, the fact it's non-consensual, the fact that you're going to be judged on it legally, just get the clear idea of what the problem is in your head. Right. And then from there, you're in a good position to start seeking out the solutions to that problem, yeah.
Well, I'd be down for some more talking by coffee.
Yeah, well, I've enjoyed this. Right. So thank really you. Great. Thank you very much. It's been lovely to meet you. And I hope that there's some good content on there that people like.
I'm absolutely sure. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.